guys.
Good afternoon.
Welcome back to our channel.
Welcome back to our channel over time.
Sorry. Welcome back. It's good to be here again.
Same here. Baby, you look pretty.
That's your word.
My money is working out.
Somebody said I'm always staring at him, and I think I would.
You just have to keep staring at me, baby.
Why? What's
because
see, as I'm saying, I'm still staring at you.
Well, that's what it is, actually. I mean, be yourself. You don't have to listen to what people are saying. Actually, it's just fine. It's just fine. I actually like you staring at me. Like, it just gives me that that feeling that
your body's moving.
No, my body's not moving. I'm just
making your body move.
Yeah, my body's moving.
Don't worry. It's your body move.
Yeah, let's start because I think it's on people's MBA, so let's get serious. This is 4:03, so let's get started. All right, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
You're welcome back to the channel, like we said. Today we're continuing on our series on wisdom nuggets on family finance. It's a big topic, actually. Two episodes we've done so far.
Yes.
Please go back and watch them. Mm-hmm. You really, really learn a lot from them. You gain a lot of wisdom from them. So today, we want to talk more about budgeting. Budgeting is a big deal in family finance.
Mm-hmm.
But the truth is, like, I always attack issues from the perspective of understanding what the problem you're trying to solve is. You cannot just say you want to solve a problem. Well, let's just have certain budgets. You guys are going to be having a lot of fights. Too many fights will actually
stay. I think first thing is understanding your personalities.
Understanding your personalities.
Your financial personalities.
Yes. What actually makes you tick when it comes to money? Like, what drives you when it comes to money? Are you a spender? Are you a keeper of money? Are you that type that likes just saving money and seeing huge bank accounts balance?
Does alerts make your heart do
like some people, or do you just feel like executing when money comes, just get things done? Those are different kinds of people you can actually have when money is concerned. So first of all, start with that understanding your financial personality before you talk about budgeting. So you have to know who is the spender in your home.
No personality is bad.
Exactly.
And in fact, it's even ideal that you both don't have the exact same personality.
Exactly.
So that there will be balance,
and a blend.
Yes.
If you're a spender and you marry a spender, you cannot budget well. That's going to be a serious trouble.
You're going to spend your future away.
Exactly. And if you marry somebody who is not a spender,
if you're both frugal, it would also affect
you. Guys are going to have a very miserable life.
Yes. Like, your children will suffer for it.
Your children will suffer for it. So there has to be a balance.
Yeah.
All right. So, having understood that, you also have to understand one more thing. We're talking about solving the problem. That's the first thing you need to know and understand, that before you even talk about budgeting, understand each other's financial personality.
Yes.
It's very, very important.
Nobody should pretend or try to be like the other person.
Exactly.
Or try to not say, oh, maybe if I say this person will think I'm wasteful or I'm extravagant.
Exactly.
Truth is, good to be yourself, so that you guys can even draw strength from each other. Like, he would, if he is the
frugal guy,
Akagon, he would learn some things from you, and if you are the spender, obviously you would also learn some things from him. So it's good to be open, be yourself. Like, let's both of you should know each other's strengths.
Exactly.
That's the beautiful thing about marriage.
So you must know each other's strengths and weaknesses about money. You must know who you can actually keep the money
who
better with the person's
the
account,
money, exactly.
And you know that money will not go missing for any reason. There will be no reason why there will be trigger happy spending.
Yes.
But you also should know the person that if you give money to, that person will not even want to release it again. There must be a balance, all right?
Yeah, so initially when we got married, I used to keep money, and he would say we want to do something, and I'll say for what.
But the truth is, I had to learn that because I am the frugal guy.
Yeah, he was very
and
frugal.
And she is a spender. But we found out that switching
I learned
our
so
roles,
much exactly.
We switched roles to
switch roles.
Okay, if I want to spend money because I'm the frugal guy, I won't come and ask you for money much. you are the spender. Anytime there's a need for you to spend, let me know.
So well, you know, both parties, people that know me, people that actually know me. When you say I'm the spender, you know, I'm sure it's
okay,
some
okay. So the spender that I mean here is you're not as frugal as me. So in relativity, okay. You're not as frugal as me. I'm a very frugal guy. I can be extremely frugal. In fact, somebody came to my house yesterday and was saying, this phone that you just got befits your person. Because there's a phone I used to use before, you don't even want to know. But me, I feel like phone, as long as the phone is
even
getting the job
phone
done.
That befits his personality, you don't want to know.
But it's doing a lot better. I mean, it's doing a lot job. A better job. Let me use that one. It's doing a better job than the previous phone before. I mean, I'm not a phone freak. I can spend more money traveling, buying books, and paying for an MBA course or something than buying a phone or something. Or
can
buying
buy
very expensive shirts.
Naira shoe.
That used to be. Yeah, my God has helped me.
But the thing is, in understanding each other's personalities, you will get to see where one person thinks he's being wise and the person is actually being foolish.
In the real sense
you see a lot of pennywise pound foolish decisions that someone is making.
Let me even give them a very practical example. Yeah. So she mentioned that I used to buy 1K5 shoe. That was 2013, 2014.
Yeah, initially when we first met. And he can run through 10 of those shoes in two years. But I will buy a shoe that is quality. I'm not after names. I don't do designer. My Pepe has very rich designer level. But I'll buy a super quality shoe that I would give out. Like it won't
spoil. At the
spoil.
End, like it won't spoil.
And I'll have. So it is exactly. In the end, you are managing, but you're spending more.
Exactly.
So you both have to bring your personalities.
Yeah, so your personalities
to
have to be well understood.
Exactly. To help your home better.
Yeah. So she helped me with that, my financial personality, that extreme frugality is not the way out. You're going to spend a lot
so
of money.
Fine.
Yeah, that's the word. I was making some money, but I was thinking let's protect the future.
Let's save for the future. So, I gave him a nickname, Mr. Future.
Exactly. I was protecting the future. I will save more. I would rather just buy things that are not so expensive or very cheap just to go by. But after a while, I found out that buying something more expensive actually helps you to save more money on the long run.
The thing is, the key word here is not just expensive. Buying something...
Maybe not expensive, things of quality.
Because there's some things, like, as much as he says, oh, I'm a spender, the truth is, if you see how I buy things in the house for the month, you'll be shocked because I don't buy things in the same place. I do market analysis.
Yeah.
As much as I'm sure he's very grateful for me because
I'm grateful, I will go and buy the best
quality thing at the place where I can get it the cheapest.
Yeah.
So my own is not about expensive. I'm not going to buy a bag because it's the most expensive bag. I'm going to buy a bag because it's going to last me. It's
exactly.
going to be quality.
Exactly.
So it is about me
quality,
rubbing up on him exactly.
Yeah. So she rubbed up on me quality wise.
Yes,
quality wise means I have to be less frugal. I have
yes.
to increase how much I
obviously
need to spend,
because quality things will cost
money
more
on, yeah.
than fake things.
And then on the long run, I found out that, for instance, there are shoes that I bought when I was about to get married
and
about 5 years ago, and I'm still wearing them now. I mean, my wife introduced me to a guy that actually made quality shoes.
Shout out Double B's.
Double B's, yeah. Shout out to you, man. Yeah, as in, and I'm still wearing that suede shoe to today. And anywhere I wear it to, they say, wow, you're wearing a nice shoe. But that was the first time I ever was going to buy a shoe that was worth 25K, 30K. I have never done it in my life. The max I've ever done before then was to buy a shoe of 3K. Not 3K5. In fact, I was looking for a 3K5 shoe for our wedding when my wife said, God did not suffer you. Don't be a sufferer. And then buy quality and then you still use it many years later. And that's what is happening right now. The first time I traveled out of the country, I bought a wristwatch. It was quite expensive. That's the most expensive wristwatch I've ever bought in my lifetime. And I'm still using it today. Please don't abuse me. Thank you in Jesus' name. I'm still using that wristwatch today. And I'm very happy about it. And the truth is, I have bought many other wristwatches in the past. And I know how many months I used them for and I threw them away. But I've used that wristwatch for 5 years now. I bought it 2015, right?
2015.
Yeah, this is sixth year now. And I'm still using that wristwatch. I won't tell you the name of the wristwatch.
Is it Baba wristwatch? Baba. And he has also rubbed off on me in that things that I probably wouldn't have thought of, like planning. Like
yeah.
I grew up
Not budgeting.
God is your father.
Yeah,
like,
anything
you need something,
get
you get
fast.
It done.
Yeah.
So like But now I plan, like I strategize. In fact, like the way I save is alarming
amazing.
To myself.
Hey, amazing.
Like I'll save a ridiculous percent of my salary.
She's now more frugal than me in saving.
Yeah, because now I realize that, okay, we would only spend on things that are extremely necessary.
Exactly.
But we will not leave out things that...
quality.
Yes, because another thing that 2019 taught us.
2019.
No, 2019. Another thing that 2019 taught us is that you won't... It's two parts. It's the part of, we're children of God.
Yeah.
We're faith people. We're not going to... Yes, we're not going to eat our seeds. We're not going to
spend
it. We're not going to suffer. Because the truth is, our future is not in our hands. One, it shows lack of faith when you want to by yourself plan your future.
Yeah.
And two, anybody can die. Anybody can die. It's true. Yes, we're not praying for death. But the truth is,
enjoy your life.
If somebody dies, it's other people that will chop your money.
So the balance.
People
is...
that probably are not even bothered about the money.
Exactly.
They're not going to be looking out for your money.
Yeah,
the truth is, you won't eat your seed. You will delay gratification.
Exactly.
But there's a balance. You won't suffer yourself now for the future. Imagine if you suffer.
And you save money and somebody else is not spending money. It doesn't make sense. So enjoy your money and at the same time plan for the future.
Enjoy on earth and enjoy in heaven.
Exactly. So the balance is this. You would have to enjoy your presence.
Yes.
Not by eating your seeds.
Yes, not by being a spendthrift.
Exactly.
What's the word? Not by being an akpa. What's the English of akpa?
Well, akpa is like somebody who is very, very...
He
spends. You just spend money anyhow.
Yeah,
you have
not
no
by spending anyhow.
Money, yeah.
You won't see something. I there are things that I've said, I need to get, and I've...
Have the money to get it.
Yes, but no,
say,
we plan
no,
it. I'll
like,
move it to April. April,
yeah.
Move it to May.
Yeah,
May,
because you're using that money to do something that
exactly,
is more productive.
Exactly, that's more productive.
That.
So, in all your spendings, try to spend from your profits. Don't spend your seed.
Yeah.
Like, if you're going to want to get something that is maybe not extremely necessary, like food, clothing, and shelter, because those are the only three things that are actually extremely essential, to be honest. Every other thing can be done without. They're just things you like. Like me, personally, I'm not a clothes person. I'm not a shoe person. I'm not a wristwatch person. I'm not a hair person. The only thing that I can say, actually catches my fancy is actually phones. And so... yeah, phones cost a lot. But the truth is, I won't be buying phone every year. I won't be keeping up because the truth is, I cannot afford it. But even if I could afford it, I won't be keeping up because who says that the phone I'm using now is bad? It's only when my phone is bad that there's a need to change my phone. But let me not digress too much. What I was trying to say is, sometimes, getting a new phone will make me happy. And I realized that I don't go out, we don't club, we don't fact we stay at home too much, so we don't spend money on other things. So sometimes once in a while you can do things that will make your physical flesh
happy, that kind of
but
stuff.
It shouldn't be an all the time thing, and it shouldn't be all your money that you use to do that.
So we've talked about personalities in terms of those who are frugal, spendthrift, or you just spend money la anyhow. Now, the truth is, we've talked about combinations that actually work too. Don't if you're frugal and you marry a frugal person, one person has to shift or else you guys will suffer.
You guys,
if you are a spender and you marry a spender, you're going to be in serious trouble because one person has to be frugal, one person has to balance.
One person has to be less frugal than the other person.
Yeah,
one person has to spend less than the other person.
So that there will be proper planning.
Or you both, even if you both don't have personality shifts, because truth is, we always like to be practical. That may not be so practical, but you both might at the same time not be the same thing at the same time.
Exactly.
What do I mean? Like, if you both are frugal, you just try not to be frugal in your decisions at the same time.
At that point in time.
Not saying, just switch your personality, because truth is, you're married already, you realize that you're both frugal. Mm-hmm. You just try to, like, be a balance. It's just like when we say, what's the example of something that we used to do? I digress, before we got married, like, mushy feeling, like we're both not crazy at the same time.
Yeah,
when I'm feeling like mushy, he cannot afford to be mushy.
Yeah, so.
Or when I'm feeling mushy, or when he's feeling mushy, I cannot afford to be mushy. That's an example. So that's the kind of way, if you guys have found yourselves, we have this personality, we're both the same way, you just try to in your decisions not be the same at that point in time.
Exactly, like just complimenting one
compliment
another.
Each other.
When somebody is crazy, like I want that shoe, I want that
car. The other person,
like,
no.
remember, we have a plan.
No, or just no.
Or just say no, like, see, we cannot do it.
I veto it. No. 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 No.
All right. So that's by the way. So that's one thing you need to understand before you think of budgeting. Because if you don't understand how you guys are different in how you see how to spend money,
when
you
get to budgeting, you're going to be fighting a lot.
Before you even do the budgeting proper, another thing you need to put in perspective, aside understanding your financial personality traits, is also the aspect of setting strategic goals for your marriage or your family. Yes. Some people set strategic goals like, yes. By the time our children are going to the university, must have this amount of money in our account for them to fund their university education. Some will say, as far as saying, our children must not go to any school other than the best school around in Nigeria. And then when they are traveling, they must go to Harvard, they must go to Stanford, they must go to Ivy League school, they can't go to any other kind of school. That's a strategic goal
for the family.
For the family. Some people have strategic goals on the family that also include things like
every year you must
do vacation, must go to different countries in the world, and we carry everybody along in the family. Nobody's going to be left behind, even if they're one day old child or something of that nature. And some people will say, no, one day old child, 1 year old child, 2 year old child, what's it going to do traveling with us? What's it going to learn? You see, there's nothing right or wrong. The most important thing is just set strategic objectives for your home.
Yes.
These are the things you want to achieve. In 2 years' time, 3 years' time, 5 years' time, are you buying a house?
Yes.
Are you going to keep renting a
house? Is it your goal to buy a house? Some people, it's not their goal, and some people, it is their goal.
Yeah, so you need to set all these strategic goals, first of all.
Yes.
Because it will determine how you even need to hustle in quotes for how much money needs to come in. If you say your children must go to Ivy League school, you can't be earning 100K per month, and you have somebody in the home who is also maybe like the husband or the wife earning 50K per month, and you have 150K per month, and you're not saying you want to set a strategic goal that all your children must go to Ivy League school. Something has to change.
You're paying $4 million for rent. Okay,
you can't even pay $4 million for rent. You're paying $1 million for rent, for instance.
Yeah.
That's not even feasible. Let's even say 500K. Whatever amount it is. For instance, some people will say, okay, the school our children are going to go to, they are of high priority to us than even the house we live. So we can live in a hut, but our children will go to the best school. Education is a priority. It's higher than any other thing on our strategic goals list. So you just set all these goals, first of all. Your taste for life, what you want as a minimum standard for your life, you have to set a strategy and strategic goals right, first of all. When you have now set all these goals, you will now have to ask yourself, how much should we be earning on a monthly basis? Or let me even say, how many children are we going to have that will fit into this goal? If you want all your children to go to Ivy League schools, that means that you are reducing the chances of them happening, the more the number of children you have. So if you want your children to go to Ivy League school, and you are having one or two children, I mean, that's fantastic. That's something that you can choose to have one because of that. And say, okay, I want my son or my daughter to go to Ivy League school, and that's what I can afford based on what I'm earning now. That's fine. But there are sometimes when people set such goals and say, okay, I can afford it with 3 children. I can afford it with 4 children. I can afford it with 6 children. There is nothing right or wrong. But you have to remember, in Jesus' name, no, I don't want 6 children, please.
Why?
No.
I want 6 now.
Because of what? There was a deal when we got married.
My mouth just said.
6 children, come.
Because I don't want 6 children, God, though. I didn't mean it, though.
Yeah, so, I mean, so you set those strategic goals. When you have set those strategic goals, they will now influence how much you need to be making as a family on a monthly basis to feed the Now, those strategic goals can now be short-term, medium-term, and long-term.
For instance,
short-term can be, we are living in a one-room apartment. Let's move to a two-bedroom flat in 2 years' time or in a year's time. And you plan that, also set medium-term goals, like in 10 years' time, we should stop paying house rent in Nigeria, we should have a house, or 5 years' time, that's medium-term. Then long-term plan can be when our children are going to the university, or when they're going to secondary school, or
when they're getting married, give each of them a house.
Something as clear to both parties as possible, set those goals. When you have now gotten the big picture about the goals, the truth is, Yoruba people will say, Like, you can just be walking around and only God actually makes grace abound to us. So that's it.
All right, so welcome back.
Yeah, sorry, we had a little glitch there. Yeah. So means you can actually be working hard, but only God actually gives the increase. Mm. Only the grace of God gives the increase. So if you set goals for your family, you need to be realistic. Set goals based on what you have right now or what you earn right now, and then pray for God to increase your income or your salary or whatever it is that brings money in for you as a person or as a family. And then when you have done that, when you're now seeing the increase coming, you can now start adjusting your strategic goals to reflect your new income level or something of that nature. Then when you have now determined your strategic goals, the next thing you now need to do is now set budgets based on those strategic goals.
Budget.
If you don't set budgets for them, if you don't, I always advise people to, if you cannot do it yourself, find somebody who is financially smart, who can use Excel spreadsheets like I use for my own personal family finance, to actually put all these strategies in place for a whole year. You should actually have all the things you plan to do,
and then you
spread your salary across that year from January to December, and talk about how much you are going to be spending on food, clothing, and share and all that, and then spend money, do a budgeting on how much you're going to pay on rent, how much you're going to save for children's school fees, how much you're going to save for even just saving for investment. You have to have all those things well planned. Giving people to help, people's school fees to pay here and there, whatever it is you want to do with money. If you don't have all these things well spelled out, you will just be building your castles in the air. You will just be believing that someday is going to happen, someday is going to happen, God is going to make it happen. But you have to plan with what you have. You have to budget per time. No money should leave your account. No money should leave your pocket without you having clarity if it meets the budget that you have already put in place. You can't afford to be spending money emotionally. That's why people end up being broke by mid-month,
no matter how much they earn,
because you just spend money anyhow. You don't have plans. Even if you want to go out, you want to go and flex, you want to go and watch a movie, you want to buy a clothes for yourself, you want to buy a phone, like my wife always says, she likes phones. You have to just have plan for it. You can't, why are you looking at me like that? You can't just wake up one morning and say, I want to buy a phone, and you don't actually have it planned. You can't say, I want to go and buy a car, and you don't have it planned. You can't say, I want to go and buy this and buy that without having it planned. So things shouldn't just happen. You have to actually plan them, because if you don't plan with what you have, you would actually spend more than what you have and find out that you are just perpetually in debt. You're perpetually in financial crisis. You just be broke
waiting
all the time,
waiting for the next payday.
There are things that you will not have to put. It's just like somebody who, let me use the scripture to give that illustration. The scripture talks about Jesus that for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. For the joy that you have set ahead of yourself as strategic goals, you have to practice the law of delayed gratification, which is you have to endure the cross. You have to endure times when you have the money to buy that phone, but you know in order of priority, that's another thing that we need to talk about. Setting your strategic goals in order of priorities. In order of priorities. If this money comes, what are we fixing first? What are we fixing after we fix this? What comes after this? In order of priority. If you don't set your priorities right, you just like something and you are emotional about it. You would have spent money on it only for you to remember that you have not paid your children's school fees. My pastor always says something in church, like if you come to me for the first time and you say, oh, you are stuck, you want to pay your child's school fees and you can't pay, you don't have money. He said he might actually give it to you, but second time, third time you are coming,
that's
it means that,
that's not being stuck.
You are not planning your life. If you're going to a very expensive school, I mean, you're sending your children to very expensive schools and you always have to look for somebody to pay the school fees for you part time, it means that you're not planning very well. That means that you're not planning with what you have. There are schools that you can actually send your children to that when you finish paying the school fees, you have change left. You have to set strategic goals and you have to be realistic in the setting of those goals, because if you don't, you perpetually be in financial crisis. You always want to borrow money to fix things.
You need help.
So the law of delayed gratification is a very important aspect or family budget, and you cannot throw it away. Except you were born into Dangote's family, and the last time I checked, those guys actually know how to manage their wealth.
Yes, they don't
give their children money anyhow. You hear Odedola buys pots for his daughters. Before he did that, he has taught them how to make money themselves. And so if he buys pots for them, he's buying it out of maybe so much profit he has made. He's not buying it from the real money he's putting into his business and all that. So there's law of delayed gratification in everything. Before you actually flex. I read something recently, and I think I want us to end with that. I shared it with you, if you remember, that don't be pushed into spending your seeds by those that are around you spending their fruits. There are some people, they are flexing around you, but they are flexing from the profits of the seeds they put into their businesses. They've done a lot of work.
Like
they have saved for so many years, so you see them traveling every year, but they are not traveling every year from their salaries, for instance. So you see them traveling every year, or they live in big houses, and you want to live in a big house, but the truth is, they are living in a big house from the excess of the cash that they have.
Yeah.
You are trying to live in a big house all the money you have in your account. It does not make sense. Don't spend your seed to gratify your desires, just like you are seeing some other people spending their fruits. They are not spending their own seeds. You don't know what they are spending, even their fruits or their seeds. You can't compare yourself with anybody. You just have to learn how to delay certain things from being gratified. Like, you're just telling yourself, okay, I'm going to have this for myself in some years to come, but for now, I need to just focus on saving and investing. You actually flex from the seed, from the products, from the profits you make from the seeds that you sow. Now, when I say sow seeds, I'm not talking about sowing seeds and maybe giving church money. That can be sowing too, but that's just one channel of sowing. And the last time I checked, God is not an ATM machine. You sow in this money, He gives you that money back.
You only reap when you sow
exactly,
into church.
Exactly. That's not even biblical.
It's not scriptural.
It's not scriptural to say when you think about sowing of seeds, all you're thinking about is sowing into church. That's not actually what we're talking about. We're talking about investing your money. Investing your money, can mean maybe sowing part of it in church. Now, when you say invest, you're not expecting that when you sow it in church, you're expecting so much money back. The floodgates of heaven that God promised when you give to God.
Testimonies like, I gave my last 3,000 and the next day they called me and somebody gave me 300,000.
That's kalukalu.
It doesn't work like
that's
that.
Kalukalu. Don't be fooled.
It
that's
doesn't
kalukalu.
Work like that though.
That is playing gimmicks with God. God is not an ATM machine. I was even trying to say something about when you give to God, all right?
Yes.
When God is going to give you back, He said in the scriptures that in the word of God that He's going to pour on you a blessing that you cannot contain. A blessing, not money. A blessing there can mean ideas, can mean open doors, opportunities
His
that
presence.
You have to harness, His presence, teaching you how to make wealth. Not necessarily like you sow money now, and just go and fold your arms. And Allah to just enter into your account. One uncle will just send you money, or one person will just send you money. It does not work that way. That's MMM in the real sense of it. Miracle money.
Money double.
Miracle money making. That kind of stuff.
Money double.
Exactly. You shouldn't think that way. So when you say sow seeds and sowing it, it can be you're paying for your tuition. You go for an MBA. And you're paying for it. You're sowing for your seeds into buying textbooks for yourself, or reading for exams, or paying for exams, like my wife just said. Or you are even putting the money into business, or putting the money into something that will reduce more interest for you. Not sowing like I'm giving to the body of Christ, I'm giving to church. We're going to talk about it maybe in the next video. The real giving that you should actually be doing. What giving is not. We'll try and deal with that in the next video. I think we have spent quite an amount of time on this.
Hours have gone by.
Yeah, but the summary is you must have a budget.
Yes.
And your budget is going to be determined by your strategic goals that you have set for yourself. Your strategic goals will be determined essentially by your financial personality,
which you have to discover and discuss
first of all before you even start setting strategic goals at all. But be realistic in setting your strategic goals. If you don't get to be realistic, you're going to run into a lot of trouble.
Yes.
You can't set strategic goals like, I want to be flying private jet next year, and your income right now does not look like going to buy a car in the next 1 year or something of that nature, or a brand new car, say. You get that kind of stuff. So you have to be realistic. You see, people use Christianity and spirituality to dabaru people's lives all in the name of God.
This
time tomorrow, you have so much more when you give,
car, you have 10 new cars.
You have to, and the scriptures, they also quote in error, like, take no thought of what you will eat or what you will wear tomorrow. Even Jesus himself said, if you want to go and actually take over a city, you have to count your costs.
You
have to plan first.
This thing is a balance.
It's a balance. You have to balance it. It shouldn't be extreme.
You're looking for, you would find an explanation
in the scriptures. In isolation.
The scripture is not, you're not going to read the letter. It will kill you.
The book of Proverbs even talked about go to the ants. They store up their food.
Yes, they plan. Yeah. They plan ahead.
Yeah, so you can't just be saying ripe cherries will fall over your head by just being so overtly spiritual. Yes. My God will supply all my needs according to riches and glory in isolation. But you have also eliminated the scripture that talks about that he who does not walk, should not eat. In fact, Paul said to Timothy, he said, a man that cannot provide for his home is worse than an infidel. But some people will say, my God will provide for all my needs. But the man has to provide for that home.
Yes.
Yeah, so you have to balance the scriptures. Sure. You have to be clear that wisdom is profitable to direct. You cannot be quoting scriptures in isolation and fold your arms and expect ripe cherries to fall over your head. It's not going to happen. If you have been a victim of spiritual scams, religious scams in the past, wake up. God, I gave you 10k yesterday. You must give me 20k today. It does not work that way. God is not an ATM
machine. Kalu.
That's what Kalu Kalu is. It's like you're playing Ludo, playing chess or card games with your destiny and your finance. You can't afford to do that. I think
time is
fast spent.
Forget to like the video, subscribe.
Like the video, subscribe,
share.
Comment.
Yes.
We want to get
Let's
some
know
feedback.
Your thoughts.
Exactly.
Yes. All right.
Thank you very much. Bye. God bless you.
Bye.
Bye.